الطير أغناها وقد جابت سماها كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ما بعد. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I announced a series a couple of weeks ago regarding the Khulafa'i Rashidin radiyallahu anhum, meaning the rightly guided Khulafa after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What we are planning to do in this particular series is to educate you and enlighten you regarding the noble rightly guided Caliphs, meaning Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali radiyallahu anhum. Because I am involved in Shia Sunni polemic, no doubt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favoured the companions radiallahu anhum to accompany and have companionship of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they sacrificed their wealth, they sacrificed so much for the deen of Islam. And after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they took it upon themselves to spread the deen far and wide. When we say Khulafa'i Rashidin, the rightly guided Khulafa, where does this stem from? This stems from a hadith from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, "Alaykum bi sunnati, upon you is my sunnah, and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa after me." Now, there's a majority opinion from the ulama that the rightly guided khulafa are Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. Some include Hassan radiallahu anhu with his short reign of 6 months before he relinquished the khilafah to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And some have also held the opinion that the fifth rightly guided Khalif was Umar bin Abdul Aziz rahimahullah, where there's a big gap between Ali radha anhu and Umar bin Abdul Aziz. But due to his justice and how he ruled, after the Khulafa had a lot of corruption in there, the early Umayyads had a lot of corruption, and he, you know, ruled Islam with justice, he spread justice, he was a rightly guided, he was very just and very, very God-fearing. So there's an opinion of that as well. So this is where this stems from. So today's episode is about Abu Bakr radha anhu, and we will do a video regarding Umar radha anhu, Uthman radha anhu, and Ali. This is regarding their khilafah. This series is going to be very, very educational, and we want you to have an attachment to the companions radhiallahu anhum to show how much they sacrificed and how they spread Islam during their reign. So without further ado, let's start this video. So this is going to be basically teaching you about their major events during their khilafah. And the book I will be using to transmit their biography is, as you can see on screen, is Imam al-Dahbi's, rahimahullah's book, Sir al-Alam al-Nubala. Okay? And he dedicated a chapter, as you can see, called Sir al-Khulafa un-Rashidun. That the biography of the Khulafa al-Rashidun, meaning the rightly guided Khulafa. So, as you can see on screen, this is the chapter of the biography of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Okay? And as you can see on screen, it mentions that his name, ismuhu Abdullah. So for those who don't know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's name was Abdullah. Okay? His real name was Abdullah. And he was also called Atiq. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's real name was Abdullah, but he was also called Atiq. Okay, so he was also called Atiq, but his real name is Abdullah. Okay, so for many that don't know, because a lot of people don't know this, that his actual name was Abdullah. So as you can see on screen, it says here that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, okay, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, they said he was the most knowledgeable of the lineage of Quraysh. It was very, very important to the Arabs, and even now it's very important. But Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was very, very knowledgeable, or the most knowledgeable when it comes to the lineage of Quraysh. Very, very knowledgeable. And as you can see on screen, he states, وَكَانَ أَوَّلْ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ. And he was the first, or amongst the first, to be a believer from the men. Okay? So he was one of the first, or if not the first, to be a believer in Islam from the men. And as you can see, he mentions the description of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. It mentions that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was white, fair, and small. So the description of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was light-skinned, but he was quite small, okay? And it mentions, and there's different descriptions, but in here it says, he was slim from the hips, that his izhar couldn't go round it, meaning he was very slim, And he's also mentioned in other descriptions that he was slim, he had slight shoulders, a thin face, sunken eyes, and his fingers were hairless, and he was very slim. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's description in terms of his physicality, he was quite slim and quite small. Okay, but he was fair skinned, but he was very skinny. So it's not all about brute force. As we know, the Prophet says a strong believer is better than a weak believer. We know this. And whilst physical strength is important, there's no point having physical strength when your iman and your taqwa and your piety and your characters and your conduct doesn't match. It has to be comprehensive. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, in terms of physicality, wasn't a big man at all. But yet, he had iman as strong as mountains. Now, to those who don't know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was a very, very wealthy individual. And he spent his wealth in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Islam. And as you can see on screen, it says Urwa bin Zubair, Aslam Abu Bakr yawma aslama walahu 40 alf dinar. He said that Abu Bakr, at the time that he embraced Islam, he had 40,000 dinar. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was that wealthy that he had 40,000 dinar at the time of embracing Islam. Subhanallah al-Azim. And it's famously reported that he freed manumitted many slaves, and most notably Bilal radiallahu anhu. He manumitted Bilal. He freed Bilal from the clutches of the mushrikeen. And as you know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was very generous and spent his wealth in the sake of Allah, or for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, freeing many slaves and aiding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have a narration here from Sunan Ibn Majah that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, لو كنت متأخدا خليلا. He said, if I was to take a close friend, meaning a khalil, the way Ibrahim alayhi salam was taken as a khalil by Allah, I would have taken Abu Bakr as a khalil, meaning as a close friend, an associate. You know, a khalil is very, very difficult to translate khalil, but meaning a close companion. So this is how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam viewed Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. After the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was elected to be the khalif. Now, the way he was elected khalif and the circumstances to him being elected is used by the Shia, generally speaking, as a kind of coup d'etat. But it wasn't like that at all. So we have a narration here, and as you can see, it says, the Khilafah of Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Now, it mentions, and this is in Al-Bukhari, that it mentions the narration, it's quite lengthy, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said those famous words, Man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa inna Muhammadan qad mat, wa man kana ya'budu Allah fa inna Allah hayy la yamut. So he mentioned those famous words that whoever worshipped Muhammad, know that Muhammad is dead, and whoever worships Allah, for indeed Allah lives and never dies. And then he mentioned the ayat from the Quran, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. And then the famous ayat, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ, that Muhammad is but a messenger, and those before him have passed away, and if he was to pass away or be killed, would you turn back on your heel? Then he mentions, the people wept loudly, and the Ansar were assembled with Sa'd ibn Ubadah in the shed of Bani Sa'dah. Then he mentioned Abu Bakr, Umar ibn Khattab, and Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah went to them. And Umar wanted to speak, but Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu stopped him. And Umar later on used to say, by Allah, I intended only to say something that appealed to me, and I was afraid that Abu Bakr would not speak so well. Then Abu Bakr spoke, and his speech was very eloquent. He said in his statement, we are the rulers and you are the ministers, meaning the helpers. And Hubab bin Munzir, he said, who's from the Ansar, he goes, no, by Allah, we won't accept this, but there must be a ruler from us and a ruler from you. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu argued and said, no, we will be the rulers and you will be the ministers, for they are the best of family amongst the Arabs and of the best origin. So you should either elect Umar or Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah as your ruler, meaning al-Quraysh. And Umar said to Abu Bakr, no, but we elect you, for you are our chief and the best amongst us and the most beloved of all of us to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Umar took Abu Bakr's hand and gave the Pledge of Allegiance, and the people too gave the Pledge of Allegiance to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And then he mentions, someone said, you have killed Sa'd ibn Ubadah, meaning that they overpowered him and they became superior. And Umar said, no, Allah has killed him. Or rather, Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Sa'd ibn Ubadah. So this was the election of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This is how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was elected. Now there is a narration that Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said, kana falta, that it was hasty. And it was because of the surrounding circumstances. The Prophet ﷺ passed away. The Ansar met in Saqifah. And this is how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was elected. Now, whilst we're on the topic, and obviously we don't want to be focusing on a Sunni Shia polemical debate, but Ali radiallahu anhu felt that he had a say in this, but the family were making arrangements for the burial. So when Ali radiallahu anhu found out, yes, he had, and he did say, there's another narration, Bukhari said, we thought we had a share in this, which is true. But Ali radiallahu anhu pledged and gave his bay'ah. And this is in Shia narrations as well. And if they say he was forced, we'll say, look, if something's promised to Ali radiallahu anhu by Allah that promise will happen. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not go against his promise. So if Ali radiallahu anhu was due to be the elected Khalif, God chose him, he was divinely chosen, how is it that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu can become Khalif and Ali pledged to him? So Ali relinquished his right, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed this, that Abu Bakr was going to become the Khalif. And Ali radiallahu anhu, you know, according to the Shia, ya'lamu ilma ma kan wa ma yakun, that he knows the knowledge of before and what's going to happen in the future. So he knew that Abu Bakr was going to become the Khalif. And we're going to get to a series on that as well, about the knowledge of the Imam. Like when we present it from their books, original and authentic authentic narrations, then we'll say, well, all right, then, you know, have you not given these attributes of Allah to your Imams? Now, after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took the Khilafah, he had a problem with the Arabian tribes. So when the Arabian tribes, because Islam spread around the Arabian Peninsula at that time, during the lifetime of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the whole of the Arabian Peninsula was under the control of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took the Khilafah, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, the Arabian tribes refused to pay zakat.
وحدي صبورا مستعينا بالصلاة كم مرة عصف الأنين بداخلي كم مرة قد ذاق قلبي من أسى محنته وكم كرهت مصابها لكن رأيت الخير يسكب في أنا كم مرة قد